Being a little slow today. There we go. Hey, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for dialing in to today's presentation featuring retired Colonel Gregory D. Gadson. I'm Captain Olson from Air Force RTC Detachment 867 at Norwich University. I'll be the moderator for today. Colonel Gadson commissioned as a second lieutenant of field artillery in 1989 from the United States Military Academy at West Point. Colonel Gadson served our nation for more than 26 years, having led various assignments throughout the world. His service culminated as the garrison commander at Fort Belvoir, where he oversaw day-to-day operations. He has tirelessly dedicated himself to leading the soldiers, civilian employees, and family members living the Army values of loyalty, duty, respect, selfless service, honor, integrity, and personal courage. Colonel Gadson, it is an honor to speak with you today. Thank you for taking the time out of your extremely busy schedule to share your experiences and lessons with us here at Norwich University. Colonel Gadson, thank you again, and the floor is yours, sir.
Well, thank you very much for the kind introduction. Perfect, by the way, short and sweet, and I appreciate that. A good afternoon to all of you. It's truly an honor and a privilege to be amongst you all this afternoon, just to kind of share a few of my thoughts and perspectives on life. I would be remiss if I didn't first and foremost acknowledge my faith in my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I know without his grace, without his mercy, I truly would not be before you all this afternoon. And so I appreciate the latitude to be able to share that first and foremost. You know, there's a lot of challenges that we have in our society, and what you all are going through, the leadership, the character, all that you develop, you know, we our country needs, our nation needs. Some or all of you are going to be leading, you know, what I consider our nation's most precious asset. It's those sons and daughters that raised their right hand and support and defend our way of life. And so that responsibility, that charter, I can think of very few things that require, that have the most honor and require the most professionalism, dedication, and leadership to make sure that we do it the right way. With that being said, I guess I'd like to kind of pick up my journey. Really about 15 years ago now. It's uh, It's actually more than that, more than about 15 years or so ago. I returned from a 1 year deployment in Afghanistan with the 25th Infantry Division. And I had gotten some good news, you know, toward the tail end of that deployment, you know, on a personal level. The big deal was that I was heading back home, obviously, but I had been selected for promotion from the rank of major to lieutenant colonel, and I was certainly excited for that. But I think more significantly, I was selected to command a battalion to lead those men and women that you see behind me in that photo, in the photo of my background. And I was super excited about that. At the time, the Army wouldn't tell me where I was going. So get used to that. They often keep those things a secret. But they did tell me they were going to leave me in Hawaii for about 6 months, just sort of as a respite, and they didn't really have anything to do with me until I was going to go to my next assignment. So with that, I decided to take a vacation with my family, and we just simply hopped from the main island of Oahu to the big island of Hawaii. Well, I'll never forget that day because I was actually sunbathing on the beach, believe it or not, working on my suntan of all things. You guys can laugh, okay? It's all right to laugh. I'm just kidding about the suntan piece, but my cell phone rang, and on the other end of the cell phone was a major general who again congratulated me for my redeployment and my promotion to lieutenant colonel, and he wanted to be the first to welcome me to Fort Riley, Kansas. And so you got to realize that I was pretty shocked. First of all, realize that I just come back from Afghanistan, and now the Army was sending me to Fort Riley, Kansas. I swear the ocean stopped. I'm like, oh my God, I just left Afghanistan. I'm going to Fort Riley. So it's really, I don't know if any of you guys are from Kansas, but it's not much difference between Kansas and Afghanistan. So I was like, oh boy. So, and I was like, well, all right, I got a few months to enjoy Hawaii. And I'm like, well, when do I need to be there? And he's like, well, we need you here as soon as you can. And so literally barely more than a month and a half back from Afghanistan, I was signing in the Fort Riley, Kansas. I would sign in, thinking I was, going to be taking command of a unit pretty soon. I didn't realize, and he didn't let me know, that the unit I was assigned to the command, it didn't exist. You know, because the Army was fighting wars on two fronts, in Iraq and Afghanistan, we had to grow the force. And the battalion or the brigade I was part of was part of the Army's expansion. And so we literally didn't exist. I was the third of really more than 400 soldiers that would eventually make up the soldiers of 2nd Battalion, 32nd Field Artillery. It didn't take me long to realize, first of all, there are no books, there are no manuals on building a unit in the Army. And I really realized that good unit or bad unit, I didn't need to look much further than myself. There was nobody to blame about how things were going to go. And so I would actually kind of rely on my experiences as a cadet, particularly a cadet football player at West Point, where I was fortunate to play for Coach Jim Young, who built a successful program during his 9-year tenure around the ideals of essentially pride, poise, and team. Now, I know that every one of you can appreciate what pride is. You think about pride, you're proud to be those that are who are in uniform and looking forward to joining the military. You're proud to wear that uniform. You're proud of what it stands for. And You're proud of your community. You're proud of your institution, and a number of things in your life that I'm sure you're very proud of. But what does that pride really mean? What is that pride about? Well, for me, and what I would instill in my soldiers, that pride was first about self-accountability. Self-accountability first to yourself. I mean, self-accountability, being accountable to yourself and understanding that you can't hold anybody else accountable until you're willing to hold yourself accountable. Holding yourself accountable to the standard, holding yourself accountable to what is right. And then and only then after you're able to do that, are you able to hold those around you accountable. Poise, well, obviously, again, I don't say obviously, but part of wearing that uniform is to have that poise, you know, grace under fire, if you will. And that's certainly a part of it. But to me, poise is much deeper than that, because poise is really about your character. Are you a person that will do the right thing for the right reason all the time, not just when someone's looking? Is your organization an organization that is going to do the right thing for the right reason all the time? You know, poise is, and having that character, I wanted to make sure that we had an organization that had character, because I undoubtedly knew, anticipated, expected that that we were gonna be put in difficult situations, and I wanted us to be prepared to handle those. And then finally, team. You know, some of you may have heard the acronym, together, everyone achieves more. Being a part of a team is being a part of something that's bigger than yourself and understanding them. I wanted men and women that came to work asking what's in it for myself, but what is it, you know, what does the team need? What does the mission need? And that, and really truly appreciating that our greater accomplishment would be done as a team and not as individuals. And so we would build the 2nd Battalion, 32nd Field Artillery around the ideas of pride, poise, and team. In a little more than 15 months, we would grow to our full strength of 400 plus soldiers. And we found ourselves as part of a brigade task force at the National Training Center in the Mojave Desert, preparing to deploy. The Army hadn't decided or wouldn't tell us whether or not we were going to Iraq, Afghanistan, but we knew that we were going to deploy. My battalion was a field artillery battalion, providing lethal and non-lethal fires for our maneuver brothers and sisters. Well, about 2 weeks into our 30-day rotation, the Army decided that we were going to go to Iraq, but we weren't going to be asked to do our traditional mission of providing fire support, but they needed us to do a security force mission. In late November 2006, the security situation in Iraq had rapidly deteriorated, and they would ask my brigade and my battalion to bolster the security by providing additional security to forward operating bases and security for our lines of logistics and communication. And so what that meant for my soldiers is that we had not only to retrain, but we had to reorganize ourselves to accomplish this mission and task. And one of the things that I'm still very proud of to this day is that my soldiers didn't complain, they didn't gripe or moan about what they needed us to do. And in the remaining time at the training center, we would in fact reorganize and retrain to the satisfaction of my division's leadership that we were prepared to execute that mission. So we would redeploy in late November 2006, and ship off our equipment in time to take a one last holiday leave over the Christmas holidays with our families. Well, when we returned in early January, I would normally say many of you will recall President George Bush announcing the surge, but I'm sure many of you were too young to truly realize that President Bush was would commit an additional 5 United States combat brigades to Baghdad alone. And the brigade I was part of was the second of those 5 brigades. And what that meant for me was another mission change. We were now asked to fight the counterinsurgency fight, fighting for the hearts and minds of the local populace while dealing with a difficult insurgent that blended in the local population. And so, you know, just with just weeks to deploy, we had to refocus our mission tasks to doing the counterinsurgency. We were fortunate that we were deployed to Kuwait, where we could continue to focus our training. But by early March of 2007, along with 2 Iraqi infantry battalions, my battalion assumed our battle space in western Baghdad, again with the mission of ending the violence in the areas that we were responsible for. Well, I can tell you that there were many difficult days in those early months of 2007. As I would tell you, it seemed that every day, just about every day, that there was a U.S. Casualty, it was a U.S. fatality. Some young man or woman would pay in full measure. And that was the environment that we were in. But on the night of May 7th of 2007, ironically, I was returning from a memorial service for 2 young men in a sister battalion from my brigade at Fort Riley. First Lieutenant Ryan Jones and Specialist Sunson were killed just 4 days earlier by an improvised explosive device or a roadside bomb. I remember, you know, that day like it was yesterday, because those 2 men, they were from my brigade, they were from Fort Riley, and it really started to sink in, you know, what was the price that people were paying here. As I headed back to my headquarters in a 4 vehicle patrol, my vehicle was struck by an improvised explosive device. The blast lifted my 15,000 pound vehicle off the road. It ejected me out of the vehicle, where I remember flying through the air and hitting the ground and coming to a rolling stop on my back. Well, I knew exactly what had hit my vehicle. It actually been, this was actually the second time that my vehicle had been hit by an IED since I'd been in Iraq. But this time was clearly much more serious. As I lay on my back, I didn't know what was wrong with me. I just knew I couldn't get up, I couldn't move. And the last thing I said was, God, I don't want to die in this country. And I went unconscious. But I was fortunate that my teammates, men like First Sergeant Frederick Johnson, he was the senior non-commissioned officer in my patrol, and my acting battalion command sergeant major. He would be the first to arrive at my vehicle when it finally came to a stop. And he was the one that recognized that I was missing. He would locate me about 100 meters or so from where my vehicle stopped, unconscious, lying in a pool of my blood, where he began to resuscitate me. A young man, a young private named Eric Brown, would put the tourniquets on my legs. a fact that the doctors give him credit for saving my life. Now, what's special about this young man, Private Brown, was that 5 months earlier, this young man was not a medic. He was actually a chemical specialist in my battalion, responsible for maintaining our nuclear, biological, and chemical equipment. But as fate would have it, this young, the medic that was assigned to my personal security detachment would slip on some ice in early January of 2007, and he broke his ankle, and he couldn't deploy with us immediately. Well, we asked, we asked the Army for a replacement medic, and because of demand, the surge, they didn't have a medic to provide us. So my headquarters first sergeant recommended and sent Private Brown to a 2-week emergency medical course at Kansas State University. This young man would finish this course just days before we were going to deploy to Iraq. Well, my chain of command suggested putting Private Brown in one of my subordinate platoons and then bringing up a medic from my personal security detachment. But I said no. First, on the basis of the teamwork and the preparation that had gone in, the months of preparation that had gone in to preparing for deployment. I didn't want to be disruptive of that. But more importantly, if this young man was good enough for my soldiers, then he was good enough for me. So I would keep this young man as my medic. As I said, the doctors credit him for saving my life. Now, just to give you a perspective again of my injuries and the environment, in those first 4 to 6 hours after I was wounded, I was administered 129 units of blood. Put that in perspective, the average human holds between 6 and 8 units of blood, between 6 and 8 pints of blood. I died 6 times. I went into arrest 6 times in those first 6 hours. And again, the environment, 131 U.S. service members would pay in full measure in the month of May of 2007 alone. So I'm telling you, it was extremely violent. It was extremely dangerous. And more than 10 times that number were severely wounded in Baghdad. So it was a very difficult and extremely difficult time. I was evacuated. It started the next day through Balad into Germany, and then on the 11th of May, I would arrive at Walter Reed Army Medical Center, intubated in an induced coma on a feeding tube. Still with my legs, but obviously very badly damaged, requiring surgery every other day to repair my blood vessels and repair, clean out my wounds and repair my blood vessels. A week after getting to Walter Reed on the 18th of May, the blood vessels in my left leg could no longer sustain blood flow, and I started to bleed to death in the intensive care. A nurse would literally pull off her belt and put a fuel expedient tourniquet on my leg. They took me into emergency surgery, and they had to amputate my left leg above the knee to save my life. The next day, the same thing would happen to my right leg, but the doctors were one step ahead, and they actually would pull a vein from my left bicep and put in my right leg, and they were able to save my right leg. At this point, I was out of my induced coma and able to communicate with the doctors, to some degree, and ultimately, I came to the conclusion that my right leg was not going to ever function as it was intended, and I would make the decision for them to amputate my right leg. So on the 24th of May, in fact, they amputated my right leg above the knee as well. When I came out of surgery, I got some more good news. they would inform me that that my right arm above the elbow and the radial head of my elbow had been broken, were broken and would require surgery to repair it. So I'd been in the hospital for a little bit more than 2 weeks before they realized my right arm was broken. And about a week or so later, I had that surgery. And unfortunately, due to the complications, I sustained ulnar nerve damage and radial nerve damage. And because of the blast injuries, my body was producing too much calcium, which caused my right arm to lock up at a right angle. I could no longer pick up my right wrist because of the radial nerve damage. And to this day, my ulnar nerve damage impacts the ability for me to use all my fingers on my right hand. So at this point, ladies and gentlemen, I was down to one functional limb. My non-dominant left arm and hand was all I could use. I was 210 pounds before I was wounded. I was now 145 pounds. And I quite honestly didn't have much of an outlook on life. And as I think back at that time, you know, you don't imagine a future when something like this happens to you. At least I couldn't imagine what future I did have or could have. And in my own way, I just wanted to quit. In my own way, I just wanted to give up. And I can remember, being discharged from the hospital and living on Fort Belvoir, commuting every day to Walter Reed for physical therapy. And one weekend, I just quit. I balled up in a corner, and I just didn't want to participate in life anymore. I didn't want to be a burden on my family. And but in all those tears, I really found out who I was. I found out that I wasn't a quitter. I was still accountable to every single thing in my life that I was accountable for before I was wounded. I was still a father. I was still a husband. I was still a soldier. I was still accountable for being the best that I could be regardless of my circumstances. And so essentially what I'm saying is I really couldn't quit. And I remember thinking, my God, what else are you gonna do me? I can't even quit. And so I decided if I couldn't quit, then I was just gonna, you know, re-engage in the life and just not worry about what tomorrow had, what tomorrow was gonna offer. I was just gonna be the best I can today because that's all I can control. My legs, it did me no good to look in the past because my legs weren't coming back. And it didn't me no good to look into the future because there was nothing I could imagine. All I could do was worry about today. All I could do was worry about being present, being the best that I could be, holding myself accountable to that. And that's when I began my journey to realize that I was not defined by my injuries. And when the Army started talking about wanting to medically retire me, I said, you know, I simply said, look, you guys are not paying me for how fast I can run. You're paying me for what I can contribute, what's in here and what's in my heart. And I wouldn't take no for an answer for being medically retired. I was going to make them. I wasn't going to voluntarily retire. I was going to, make them throw me out. So I would apply to continue on active duty. As I was recovering and working my way back into life, I would complete a graduate program at Georgetown University and in the JCS intern program. And following that, I completed my War College Fellowship at the Institute of World Politics. Just short of finishing my my War College Fellowship in early 2010, the Army would approve me staying on active duty. And in June of 2010, I assumed duties as the director of the United States Army Wounded Warrior Program. And in the Army's greatest sense of humor, in August of 2010, I would be selected for promotion to colonel. And in the following year, I was selected to command a command at the colonel level, where I would command a garrison at Fort Belvoir, Virginia, in my last assignment in the Army. Now, you know, my story is, it can be anybody's story. My story is about overcoming, and all of you have stories about overcoming. Never compare yourself to the other person. This is about being the best that you can be. That is your character. That is what this education, that is what this opportunity that you have every day to work on, is being the best that you can be. If I can encourage any one thing to you, it's not any one thing, it's this. This is my lesson to you all. First, be present. You cannot live a day that you're not promised, and you cannot live a day you've already lived. Me losing my legs were not gonna grow back. So it did no good for me to wonder what if. It did me no good to look in the past. My legs were never gonna come back. And I quite honestly could not imagine a future. I hope none of you ever has to imagine a future like this. But my future was a blank slate. So all I could do was apply my energy to being present. Because guess what? Tomorrow is not promised. Every single one of us here, one day will not have a tomorrow. So why worry about a day that you won't have? Focus your energy on being the best that you can be. Because if you can do that, you will build in yourself a character to deal with anything that life throws at you. You will be prepared to handle anything that life throws you because you can focus yourself on the task at hand. You can apply yourself. You cannot worry about the past. You cannot worry about the future. You can focus yourself here. That's what resiliency is. Resiliency is character. Resiliency is not something you pull out of your pocket and say, I've got to be resilient. You live it every day. And every day you have a chance to contribute to it, to build on to it, or every day you have a chance to not. This is a journey, and we don't get there. It's not about the destination. The destination is when we're done. Being present is being able to apply yourself to be where you are, not where you want to be, not where you're dreaming, and not holding or being encumbered by something that didn't go your way or by something you're dragging in the past. Focus your energy on being present. Focus your energy on being your best. And if you can do that, then what I say is you can be at peace. You don't have to wonder what if. You don't have to wonder. You can be at peace. Doesn't mean you like everything that happens. Doesn't mean you agree with everything that's happened. But look, you did your best. You are present. Then you can accept it. You got to accept it. You can be at peace and you can move on. That ladies and gentlemen, in my opinion, is what this journey of life is about. Those that you that wear the uniform and will serve your nation in uniform or out, you have an opportunity every day to make the most of that day. And when that day is gone, you can move on to the next one. So with that, I'm not sure how much you guys know about me, but I that's what I really wanted to deliver to you. That's what I really wanted to focus. And I'll open up the floor for any questions that you all might have. I'll turn it back to you.
Thank you, sir. Your message and your story is truly one that it hits in the heart, and I appreciate you coming and talking to us right now. We'll open up, like you stated, we'll open up for a Q&A session. So if anyone has any questions, feel free to put them in the chat. And then I'll read them off. And then, sir, it's up to you how long you want to stay. I'll shut off when you want to shut it off, sir. So
okay. Have a question? No.
So we do have a question right now from Cadet Runyon. Sir, how do you remain in the present? What does it look like for you practically? What techniques do you see or use?
Right. Well, great question. So it's, to me, being present starts with being aware, self-aware. I certainly can't judge any of you for your ability of being aware, but where's your mind? Where's your energy? Where's your focus? I began to kind of understand my self-awareness as an athlete, as a college football player. Our coach used to say to us, play the play you're in. And what that meant was, look, you might have made the greatest play or you might have blown a play, but you've got to line up. You can't hold on to that. You can't be basking in the glory or downing yourself for something that didn't go the way you wanted. You got to focus your energy on what you're doing. And that's about self-awareness. It's about concentrating. And so do you find yourself drifting? Do you find yourself in a meeting or thinking about the next class when you're in the class that you're in? When you're doing a task, are you thinking about or worried about the next task? Those are signs and those are thoughts that you've got to gain awareness of to begin being able to curb that and realize that, look, I'm not present. You find yourself in a conversation with someone and you're thinking about something else. That's an example of not, those are examples of not being present. And so that to me is, and look, I wish I could say I'm perfect at that, but I'm not. But I've learned to be self-aware so that when I find myself not focused on what's at hand, not focused on the person that I'm addressing or that I'm in communication with, or I'm worried about something else that I'm not there, then I bring myself back.
Thanks, sir. So we have another question from Matt Candy. Sir, is there one thing you could go back and change about your time as a second lieutenant? What would it be and why?
Well, great question. And it's one that, my first answer is no. And I say that not because I did everything perfect. I was far from it. But I'm the sum of my experiences. I'm the sum of my successes and I'm the sum of my failures. And so this old colonel that's retired colonel that's talking to you is the sum of those things, of those screw ups. I will tell you this though, I'll share this with you. During the first Gulf War, Desert Shield, Desert Storm, I had one of my soldiers that was wounded. And I don't think that we did the best job of he survived and he didn't have any life-maiming injuries. But as I look back at that incident, I looked myself in the mirror and I felt like we were not prepared. We were not prepared to the best that we could have been. And I used that to drive my responsibility, my acknowledgement that you know, we are in a life and death business, and what we do and don't do has consequences. And I did not live up to my responsibility as a lieutenant. That's, you know, and a man could have lost his life or lost a limb because of that. And I promised myself from that day on that I would never let that happen. And ironically, the men and women that I was responsible would have my life in their hands. I could have never imagined that. And I'm here today because of them.
Thank you, sir. So we have another one that's kind of, I lumped two together. It's about your time back in West Point. So what is the lesson that you learned from West Point that you believe the most valuable for your career? Or what is the biggest takeaway that West Point taught you or you learned from your time there?
Wow, that's a... You know, wow, what is the most? West, wow, that's what is the one thing? I would just say, West Point was just the beginning. West Point was just the beginning of a journey that would kind of expand my mind of the possibilities of what we're capable of, what we can aspire to, what we can be. It is not a crowning achievement. It is not a, I mean, I'm proud. Look, I'm not saying I'm not proud I went there or whatever. I've got some wonderful friends. I met my wife there. She's my classmate of 32 years. Maybe that's the best thing, is my wife. But really, I will tell you, it was a gift of a toolbox, an understanding, an appreciation for understanding and appreciation of what I could be, what we can be, what we can achieve, and really kind of that's the gift that West Point gave me.
Thank you, sir. So we have another one from Cadet Gaynor here. Sir, when are you working with someone who feels they've gotten to an all-time low in their life, what is the best way as a leader to help them get back in a positive mindset?
I think one of the best things we can do as friends or somebody is just be a good listener. Being a good listener and being humble is extremely powerful in my opinion. A lot of times people aren't looking for an answer and they don't need an answer. They just need somebody to just be a good friend and be a good listener. Just be reassuring and listen and be there.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate that.
Yep.
We have Cadet Evans here is asking, kind of going back to how you had to recreate the new, organization, the new unit. So, sir, when in the Army, essentially assigned you to the new initiative for expansion, and you had to unexpectedly build a new unit. And boy, how did you handle this curveball positively? So, it's how did you make this unknown come back
and
make everybody
well. I'm telling you, as I think back about it now, I was like, I mean, it was sort of like I felt kind of lost and unsure, and probably just, you know, as I said, I knew we were gonna go to combat, and I really focused us on taking care of each other. This journey is not about me; it's about us. And if I could help us figure out that this was about us and not about me or you, that we had a good chance of being successful. Now, what I will say, and probably singularly the thing I am most proud about my military service, is that when we did deploy on that deployment, I was one of six battalions on a 15-month deployment in an extremely violent period in Iraq. And my battalion was the only one of six in my brigade that brought everybody back alive. And you know, that's what I was proud of. And we took care of each other, and we were blessed. That's what I'm not taking credit for it. I'm saying that's what we did, and you know, by the grace of God, everybody came back alive in my battalion.
Thank you, sir. We have another one from Cadet Diallo. So as you, I don't know if you can see the chat, but they pile up pretty quick. So. I don't know if we're going to have time actually to get to all of them, but I will keep going as long as we can. So Cadet Diallo says, sir, I appreciate how your faith is important to you. Do you think this helped strive, helped you strive in your service, and how specifically?
Yes. You know, for me, it is about my faith. It starts with my faith. My faith gives me, is my example, gives me, is where my humility starts. You know, I was gonna leave this as sort of a parting shot, but, you know, remember as a leader, you know, it's not about you. If I could beat something into your heads, remember, this is not about you. It's about them. You know, people would come up to me, Colonel, you know, sir, how do you like it? How do you want it? What do you like? And I would always say, what's the standard? What's the book say? It's not about me. Don't ever fall in the trap of what do you like or how do you want it? You know, military is great because we got standards. We got standards for everything. And you don't need to exceed the standard. You just need to live up to the standards. There's so many, you'll never wrap your mind around all of them, but hold yourself to the standard. And if you can hold yourself and you can hold your organization to the standard, you'll be way ahead of the game. I promise you, you'll be way ahead of the game. Don't ever let it become about you. Because it's not. And so my faith, I tie that to my faith because my faith keeps me humble. I am servant. I am serving you. I am serving you to make sure that we can be successful. Not for you to make me look good, not for you to make me happy. My responsibility is to see us be successful. So keep that to heart. It's not about you. It's about them. It's about those sons and daughters that you're responsible for, that you have been entrusted to lead.
Thank you, sir. So we'll have one last question, and then I think we'll end it there if that's okay with you, sir.
We can go. We'll just call it a top of the hour.
Yes, sir. Okay. So we have one from Cadet Cahill. Sir, how do you manage your family life and your military life during these deployments?
Yep. Great question. So I don't know. I show of hands, you know, everybody's trying to seek balance. Yeah. How do you balance this and how do you balance that? Well, first of all, I think balance is a fallacy. There's no such thing as balance. But how do I manage it? How do I live it? I'm present. Now, I wish I had figured that out, you know, when I was a lot younger, but you know what? It's really about balance. It's about being present. And I'm coming back. I'm consistent. Be present. That's how you manage it. When you're at work, don't be at home. Be at work. Be present. Be where you're at. Focus on being present. And then when you go home, don't bring work home. Be present. Be with your family. Be a husband. Be a wife. Be a parent. Focus on them. Be present. You know where we screw it up? Is when I'm at work, I got family. And when I'm at home, I got work. And I'm doing none of it to the maximum, to the best of my ability. That's where we mess it up. Be present. Focus your energy on being where you're at. And then when it's time to shift and lift and shift those fires, when it's time to transition, then transition. If you can do that, you're going to be you're a superstar.
Yeah, that's spot on, sir. Especially in today's modern world, sometimes you have to turn off that phone and be present at home and be at work when you're at work. And I think nowadays we're getting easy with that easy access that's on the phone, and we just keep going at it. So,
right, and to your point, it's discipline. Yeah. It's discipline. Can you not pick up your when you go home? Can you not pick up your phone and start checking emails? Can you not email somebody when they're supposed to be home? Can you respect that? Can you respect their time? Key things to think about. Are you willing to respect your subordinates' time by not sending them texts and emails?
Yes, sir.
Understand when there's an emergency, and if there is an emergency, treat it as an emergency. But if you routinely do it, you're wrong.
It's a great, great takeaway, sir. So with that, I have Colonel Smith, the commander of the Air Force Artillery Detachment 867, asked to say a few words at the end. So I'm going to unmute him real quick, and then I'll let him go for it. So here he goes, sir. Colonel Smith, are you able to chat, sir?
Yeah, I can shoot loud and clear. Hey, Colonel Gadson, thank you very, very much. Hey, before I forget, Colonel Gadson, just on behalf of the President, Mark Anarumo, on behalf of my fellow colonels here at Norwich, Colonel Scott Conway, he's an Annapolis grad. Colonel Joel Newsom, he's a West Point grad. Colonel Mike Titus, he's a graduate of the Spine Institution here at Norwich. I just went to college. I just went to a university, so I don't have the distinguished history that all these guys do. But anyways, and on behalf of Dr. Afanita, she's our provost, this is exactly the message that I'll speak for myself. This is the message that I needed to hear based on just the last, you know, year or so. It's been hard. It's been hard for everyone, whether you're a rook freshman or whether you're faculty cadre and you're supposed to have life figured out. I think what you've shown us through the message of self-accountability, poise, team, and ultimately being present, which it's so hard nowadays. And I'm not saying it's hard, it's impossible, but it's just challenging. And I think you reminded us what's important in life. And on a personal note, I'd like to thank you for being the commander over at Fort Belvoir. You were my servicing base when I was stationed. You were the commander there when I was stationed at the Pentagon. And I just wanted to thank you for, you know, your leadership. And I honestly did not know your story. And not that it mattered. I still got the same support, great support regardless, but I could tell it was because of your leadership. And I think you fixed a lot of stuff in the medical community there for sure at the hospital and other things amongst, you know, just amongst that. So thank you very much just for your leadership. I would also be remiss, Colonel Gadson, if I didn't say that West Point is about ready to get a beat down at Saturday at 1300. Norwich Rugby is playing West Point here on the fields of friendly strife. And I'm sorry in advance, I'm calling the shot, but Norwich is going to take down West Point. And I'll make sure that I send you a nice follow-up email, if that's okay.
Yeah, well, we should put a wager on that or something, you know.
I'm down with that. And maybe the other Division I sports, maybe not so much, but certainly from a rugby perspective.
Yeah, no, I'll take the rugby game.
All right. Sounds good. And I will pay up. I lost the championship match last night. I went for Gonzaga. My wife went for Baylor. She graduated from Baylor. So I'm already, hey, I'm 0-1. So I might, you know, I might as well double or nothing, right?
Yeah. So, you know, I did call Baylor. I didn't have any dog in a hunt. I was actually playing against their win streak. You just, how many times do you have perfection? And that's what I bet against.
Right. And so in that context, Colonel Gadson, the next time the Patriots are preparing for the Super Bowl, if you could not talk to the team that they're supposed to play, I would really appreciate that, because the words of inspiration and motivation that you provided to the Giants was enough to tip those scales. So I'll make sure that whatever you need, I will provide the next time the Patriots play whoever they play. So just deal.
All right. Deal.
All right. Thank you, sir, very much. Again, on behalf of all the leadership here at Norwich, on behalf of the cadets, on behalf of, you know, this, we're the, you know, the student body cadets for that matter. Thank you very, very much. It was valuable. I mean, I, for one, took 4 pages of notes, so I will definitely incorporate this message into my personal and professional life going forward. Thank you, sir.
Well, thank you. And God bless to all of you. And again, thank you for being here today.
Awesome. Thank you. But.
Thanks, sir. Everyone, this video will be, it's recorded and we post on Norwich's website. Within probably tonight or the next couple of days. So if you want to go back and watch it again, it'll be a resource you guys can use in the future. So please do that. But thanks again, sir. I really appreciate you dialing in. And if you'd like to stick around after everyone drops off, we can chat for a bit.
I'll stay around for a few minutes. Sure.
Thanks, sir. But everyone else, you're free to drop off and have a good rest of your day. If you're heading your lead labs or your mill labs or whatever you have going on. So thank you.
Thank you.